Hey everyone. Like everyone else, I've been playing with ChatGPT a little bit, and I thought I would try and put together some of my other hobbies, Azure AD and PowerShell. Because you see a lot of people talking about, hey, it writes code for us, it explains code, so I thought I would give it a go and see what the results were like. Now, before I get into that, I wanted to stress just a couple of key points. Remember, ChatGPT and GPT in general is a large language model. It is not a general artificial intelligence. It is not capable of different types of work and learning new things. It is based around predicting the next word in a sequence. Then after it predicts that word, it can feed it back in and then predict the next word, the next word, and the next word based on this huge amount of training data, based on supervised training, based on a reward function that's made it phenomenal. But it's going to just keep predicting the next word until it predicts it should have an end or a stop token. So it's not really thinking. There could be a whole argument about what is thinking. It's predicting the next word in the sequence. But because of this huge amount of training data and this phenomenal model, it's generating these fantastic outputs. But it is predicting the next word based on what it's been trained on. So it is not perfect by any means. Do not rely on, for example, generated script, generated code. It'll be a good starting point. It might help me fill in some, hey, I should think about these things, but I should definitely go and validate what it is doing. It's predicting based on what it was trained on. So if, for example, there was garbage in, there'd be garbage out. Now, because of the sheer volume of data it's been trained on, I would expect its predicted output to be good, but I still want to validate it. Second key point, this is public domain information. Do not put anything into ChatGPT that is your private intellectual property, that is PII, that is data that should not get out there on the internet. So be careful what you type in. I don't believe at the moment it's continually training, but I think it talks about, hey, we might use this to tune in the future. So don't put anything that is private, that you don't want there in the public domain. I would use this for maybe bits of documentation, helping me understand what's going on. If I get an error, I could copy and paste it in there. It might help me explain what something's doing, but I'm not putting anything secretive in there. Do not put in private data. Now, the other key thing to think about here is it's obviously trained on a certain set of data. If I just go into here, for example, and I do reply with above message, there's a whole set of pre-trained things that are stated before it starts talking to me. So if I look at what it's telling me, notice the cutoff is up to 2021. It does know today's date, but its information that it was trained on is only up to 2021. And I think it's actually September 2021. So it doesn't know things past that date really. And because it's a large language model trained, it's actually fairly hard to update things. So that's an important thing to understand about what exactly it knows. But with all that said, let's try and do something. So what I'm going to try initially is, well, can it create me a PowerShell script to send me an email when someone modifies an Azure AD group? So I'll paste this in. And remember, what it's doing is it's firstly parsing what I type in, and it's looking at what should it pay attention to. Out of all those things, what should it pay attention to? And then it's going to go and actually say, okay, well, this is what we should do to solve that problem. Now you'll notice straight away, it's actually using the Azure AD module. So it's telling me to install the Azure AD module, and then it's using SendGrid, and then it's going through and generating my code. Remember, the Azure AD module has really been replaced by Microsoft Graph. So it's giving me information about maybe what was predominant at the time when it was trained, but we can see it's creating me a script. So that's great, and it's going to go through and continue and give me this output. So that's a way of achieving my goal. And you'll notice the way it's writing it is one word at a time. And it's giving me instructions on what to do. And then it's continuing, predicting what the next thing should happen until it gets to a point where it's predicting, hey, I should stop. Now, it's not using the Microsoft Graph, which I would like it to do. So what I could try doing again is, well, hey, create me a PowerShell script using Microsoft Graph to try and force it to now use the more modern approach in how I want to do this. So now it's going to use the Microsoft Graph API. And remember, there is a Microsoft Graph PowerShell module. So once again, it's now giving me instruction on how I can do this, creating an Azure AD app, which would be my service principal. It's granting various permissions it would need. And now it's saying, hey, the information I would have got from that app registration I would have created, I'm going to populate the details. Well, and straight away, this should start to give you a little bit of concern in a way. Because remember, what is it doing in this script? It's saying, hey, look, put your app secret actually in to my code. I would never obviously do that in the real world, but it's just giving me some, hey, ideas of what a basic script would be, but I wouldn't just want to do this. My secret should be somewhere else. Maybe I could use a managed identity instead, but there's other ways I would think about doing this. But the whole, I think I actually just broke that a little bit. Let's do continue. To make it try and finish off that script. But the key point is, even straight away, it's going to use the REST API. So we can see, sure, it's using Graph, but it's doing it via the REST API at this point. It's not actually using that Microsoft Graph PowerShell module. So although it is going to work from PowerShell, it's not maybe doing exactly what I would want it to do. Is it functional? Sure. But hey, it's just using that RESTful API. But this is, again, definitely something I could start with. Now, what's interesting about this is I can interact with this. So notice it's telling me, hey, look, put your app secret in this code. Maybe I want to ask it a question. Let's ask it. So this is one of the fun things you can do. Is it a good idea to put secrets in code? Now, the whole point of ChatGPT as well is it has context on a large number of tokens in the history. I can't remember if it's 3,000 or 5,000, but it's tracking back the previous things it's done. And hey, it's telling me, no, it's not a good idea to put secrets in code. Passwords, API keys, other sensitive information in code can make them visible to anyone who has access. How many times do we see it show up in GitHub? So I can go and validate things. That's one of the great things about this is if I see something and I don't think it's right, ask it. Say, hey, I saw you doing this. Is this a good idea? Why did you do this? And it's actually helping me out there. But in this case, it didn't really do exactly what I wanted to, because I really want to try and use the Microsoft Graph PowerShell module to get my script. So what's another approach that I could maybe try to achieve this? So what I could do is, what about if I say create a modern PowerShell script to notify me via email when someone modifies an Azure Active Directory group? Let's try that. So hopefully modern will trigger it to say, hey, actually, there's a Microsoft Graph PowerShell module I could use. So it's telling me about, hey, making sure you have the latest PowerShell modules installed, and hopefully, okay, so it's using the AZ. And it's talking about authenticating, and then it's going to use a script. So define the Azure AD group to monitor, and then it's setting up the email parameters. So this time it's assuming that you have authenticated already. And now it's just going to set up that connection. So now it's using the AZ capability to interact with objects. So it's still not using the Microsoft Graph PowerShell module, but it's giving me an alternate approach to, instead of using the Azure AD module, now it's using the AZ module and its capabilities around it. So it's pretty interesting. You can see how I can converse with it and try and get it to do different things. So if we, again, we scroll all the way back, the first time it was actually going to go and use the Azure AD module, I said, hey, is there a modern approach? And then with the modern approach, it's actually now going to use the AZ AD group, which is some of the basic functionality I get. So we can get an idea of what it's doing, and it's pretty cool. And again, if there's things you didn't like about it, you could go and question it and ask it, hey, why did you do this? But it's notice it's telling me in advance, I must have already run the Connect AZ account before I run this script. And this script might work, and there's probably things I want to tweak about it. Something else that it's really useful to do is, hey, maybe I've got some code. I'm like, can you tell me what this code is doing? So can you document this PowerShell code? So maybe you inherited some code and you're really not sure what it's doing. So in this case, I'm just telling it the code and it's creating comments to describe what it is doing. Now, once again, to my original warning, be careful what you do here. Because if this was proprietary code that you definitely didn't want out on the internet, you may want to give some consideration to, hey, what am I pasting into this public engine? But if it's just some basic script that's not super private, then hey, this would be a nice way to go and understand exactly what it is doing. And you notice, so it commented the code for me, and now it's going through and describing, hey, here's what this is actually doing. And if you think about how this is functioning, if you consider this is just predicting the next word, this is phenomenally powerful because it's been trained on so much data and it's bringing all of those together and predicting what should come next. And you see this one word at a time showing how it's thinking and how it's just predicting the next word and the next word until it predicts that stop token and it's back over to me. And it can also help me understand things. Now, the power from this can come in how I prompt it. But I could say, okay, well, what is the authorization code flow? Maybe I don't understand some concept. And once again, based on its prediction, based on the training data, which I think was most of the internet, it can go and explain it to me by all of that data, and it's got those links through its neural network of the connections between all of the tokens, tokens being words. It has all of its parameters, which are the various weightings and biases between the nodes and how it should output. It's giving me this text that describes it. But one of the things to always remember is just a prediction engine. And it will always seem like it's absolutely authoritative. But it would still seem that way, even if it's wrong. So if I say, who is John Saville? I tried this, and it was interesting what it spat out. Let's see what it comes up with this time. I don't honestly know what it's going to say. But it mixed in some things that were true with some things that were not true. But if you just read it, you would just believe it was absolutely the correct thing. So apparently I'm a well-known expert, which is fantastic. I like to be an expert in cloud computing, virtualization. Now, people might straight away say, no, John is not an expert in any of those things. Author of several books. Yep, also true. I think this is basically obviously coming from training of maybe other sites about me, because that's kind of old. But that's newer. Okay, so that I don't think is true. So I don't think I've ever written a book called the Hyper-V Cookbook or Windows Server 2012 Hyper-V Installation and Configuration Guide. I am an MVP. Well, I was an MVP before I joined Microsoft. So that's true. But the point is, it's predicting next words. So in this case, I've written books on Hyper-V. I've written books on Windows Server 2016. But it's predicting most of the time when someone has written Windows Server 2016, in this context, Hyper-V would come next. But I haven't. I don't know what Redmond Magazine is. Founder and CEO of Savilltech Limited, a technology and consulting firm based in the UK. I guess maybe you could say that. My point is, it seems very authoritative, but it's just predicting what should come next based on its training data. And in this case, some of it is wrong. I have never written a Windows Server 2016 Hyper-V cookbook. I've never written, to my knowledge, a 2012 Hyper-V installation and configuration guide. I've never written for Redmond Magazine, whatever that is. So just take it with a little grain of salt. I would consider it a great platform, as I was talking about, to get a starting point, to hey, maybe it can help create me some structure for something I want to do. But do not just assume it's the answer. You want to then go and validate. But I think if you use it the right way, if you remember that, hey, I want to be careful what I put into this, but if I want to use it for maybe getting some explanations of things, to give me some structure of what I do, to give me a starting point, I think it's fantastic. And it's kind of fun to go and use this thing. And that was it. It seems like a pretty cool thing. You do have to remember its training date is a little bit old at this point. I'm sure there'll be updates, but that's a fairly complicated thing to do for these massive language models that take a really long time to train. So there's a certain reason that the data is old. But yeah, I think with Azure AD and PowerShell, certainly I can use this to really help me create my scripts. So that was it. Until next video, take care.